Welcome to the lecture series on PC354 microprocessor. In the last lecture, we had gone through the timing diagrams. From today's lecture, we are going for the memory design, that is the design and operation of the 8085 memory that we are supposed to interface with the microprocessor. Okay. So initially, we will discuss the basic memory design, and later on we will proceed further for the memory interfacing with the microprocessor. Okay. So let us start with the design and operation of memory. Now, for every microprocessor to store information in form of data or in form of program, memory is required. So basically, there are two types of memory for a microprocessor based system. In that, the first one is the main memory, and the second one is the secondary memory. The main memory basically comprising of, that is, RAM, ROM, and the secondary memory comprising of, that is, the disk drives we are having, okay, optical disks we are having, okay, and whatever the floppy disk and other . So let us proceed further, that how the information is exactly accessed from the memory, to understand the proper design and operation. Let us first start with accessing information from the memory. So basically, to access any kind of information from the memory, what exactly the microprocessor is doing is that whatever the data or the program, or we can say the information that is stored in the memory, so initially the first step that is being performed by the microprocessor is the chip select part. So chip select is having importance while we discuss the memory interfacing later on. Okay. So in chip select part, a particular memory chip is being selected by the microprocessor first. Okay. That to which memory the microprocessor wants to access the information, that is the chip select. Once the chip is being selected, the second step is to identify the memory location, means on that memory which location is supposed to be accessed. Okay, that is the second step, to identify the memory location. And in the third step, that is access the data, that is, the data is being accessed from that particular memory location. So this is how the data is accessed from memory. So basically, we are having these three steps, that is the chip select, then which memory location we are supposed to access, and then finally access the data from that particular memory location which is being selected. Okay. So this is how the information is accessed from the memory. Now, while going through the design of the memory, in the designing of the memory, there are few basic elements which are being involved. So in that, the first basic element that is involved in the designing of the memory are tri-state buffers. that is an important circuit element in the designing of the memory. Okay, so basically a tri-state buffer is having three logic states. Okay, so basically three logic states are there, that is logic 0, logic 1 and high impedance. So basically there are three logic states for a tri-state buffer. Okay, so we are having logic 0, logic 1 and a high impedance state. Okay, let us go through the structure of a tri-state buffer. So basically it is having an input, output and one enable pin. Okay, this enable pin can be active high or active low depending on the tri-state buffer. Okay, so whenever the enable signal, we put a bar on that, okay, it will become an enable or active high or active low signal. Okay, so we do have this as an active low enable. So depending on the enable signal, what we are having, if the enable is active, only then the input will reach to the input pin. Okay, otherwise this input will behave as high impedance, means it is not being connected. It will behave as that it is not connected to the input circuitry. Okay, so basically tri-state buffer is having three states, that is if the input is 0 and if the enable is being activated, the output is 0. If the input is at logic 1 and enable is activated, then the output is at logic 1. Okay, and if the enable is not active, then the input is not connected to the circuitry. Okay, so that is we have for a tri-state buffer. That is the one of the memory element that is being used, okay, in the designing of the memory. So it is having this three states, that is logic 0, logic 1 and high impedance state. Okay, so later on we will use tri-state buffer in the designing of the memory. Okay, so this is how it exactly works. Okay, so let us go with the basic memory element. Now see that this basic memory element is comprising of a D latch. Okay, as you had learned in your digital electronics paper, that a latch is having a capability to store one bit of information, or you had learned flip flops. Okay, so the basic memory element is same as, the working is same as like D latch. Okay, so for a particular D latch, the structure is like this. For a particular D latch, we are having D as the data input, D as the data input, we are having Q as the data output, we are having this data output, and we are having enable signal. So whenever the enable is active, only then the input signal will reach to the input. Otherwise, whatever the information which is being stored inside this D latch, that is available as the output data. Okay, so this is the D latch, that is the basic memory element. Okay, so which depends on the enable signal.
Okay.
Now, in this case, the input, you can see that in a D latch, the input is always available, as shown in this diagram. That is always given to the D input point. Okay. So, to control the structure, if on the input side and on the output side, if on the input and output side, if we add the tri-state buffer that we are using, okay, if we add the tri-state buffer that we have learned, okay, then it will provide the controlling. On the input side, we will use the write signal as an enable signal, and on the output side, we will use the read signal as an enable signal. Okay. So, in the earlier circuitry, we had seen that the input is always available to the D input pin. So, for a controlled manner, if you want to provide a control to this circuitry, if we add a tri-state buffer on input as well as output of this D latch, then only when this memory element is supposed to be written, or if something is to be written on this memory element, then this write signal is being given to this tri-state buffer, and only the data input will reach to the D. Only then it is being written to that D latch. Okay, and whenever the data is supposed to be read from that particular D latch, then the read signal will enable this tri-state buffer, and only then the data output can be read from the output of the D latch. Okay, so that is the basic memory element. Okay, so input, on input side we are having tri-state buffer with write signal, on output side we are having tri-state buffer with read signal. Okay, so that is the basic memory element. Okay, so this basic memory element, or you can say this one D latch, can store one bit of information. Okay, so this is for one bit of information. Okay, so this structure, this memory element, is for storing one bit of information. Okay, now if we are going for a larger bit of information, okay, then in digital electronics there is a concept of registers. Okay, so let us go with a memory register. Let us go with the memory register. Okay, let us go with the design of a memory register. And let us first go with a 4-bit memory register. So register is nothing but, again, you can say that it is also one of the basic memory element. Okay. So if we put 4 D latches in series, it will make a register of 4-bit, which can store 4-bit of information. Okay. So let us go with the design of a 4-bit memory register. Okay, so earlier what we had designed, a memory element which can store 1-bit of information. So if you want to store 4-bit of information, then we need 4 such elements. Okay, so we are having this D latch, that is the first one. Second one and the third one. Okay, so if we are having these 3 memory elements, okay, there is the first one, second one, and the third one. Okay, then if we draw the same D latch, okay, then give me a minute. Thank you. Okay. Now see that if we go for this D latch, okay, then if we are going for the same D, Q, and we are having the same enable, the same thing we are having D, Q, and enable. Again, this D, Q, and enable. This D, Q, and enable. Okay. And if we put a tri-state buffer on each and every input, as we are doing earlier also, if we put a tri-state buffer on each and every input like this, okay. Now, from that tri-state buffer, these are the input signals. These are the input signals that we have. Okay, so that input signals we will name, that is I0, I1, I2, and I3 as the input signals. Okay, now let us go with the enable for this tri-state buffer. Okay, so on input side we are having this write signal. We are having this write signal. Okay, so collectively we will connect all this input with one enable, that is the write, because the 4 bit of information is going to be written on each and every part of each and every input of this D latch. Okay, so this will be the input part. The enable pin of the D latch is again connected in series with the enable input EN. On the output side again we are having a tri-state buffer. On output side we are again having a tri-state buffer. That tri-state buffer is connected to the output pins, output 0, output 1, output 2, and output 3. Okay, and it is having this tri-state buffer as the read signal. So this read signal are again connected collectively, and it will provide this read control signal. Okay, so this is the read signal. Okay, these are for write signal. Okay, and these are for enable. Okay, so this is the structure of a 4-bit register. This is the structure for a 4-bit memory register which can store 4 bit of information. Okay, so when this write signal is being given as well as the particular location is being enabled and the inputs are being given, so all the 4 bits are being written by the microprocessor. Okay, in the same way on the output side this read signal is being given, so this 4 bit register can be read. Okay, so this is the structure for a 4 bit memory register. So this is the structure for a 4 bit memory register. Okay, now let us proceed further with a group of memory registers. Okay, so this is a 4 bit register. If we are going for a 4 cross 4 group of registers, means if we take 4 such registers and we connect them in parallel. Okay, if we take 4 such registers, so we are having 4 registers, each register can store 4 bit of information, so that will make a 4 cross 4 memory which is having 4 locations and each location can store 4 bit of information. Okay, so let us proceed further with the group of 4 registers, or let us try to go with the design of a 4x4 memory which is having 4 locations, each location comprising of a register, you can say. So memory is nothing but a group of registers. Okay, so let us go with the group of memory registers. Okay, now in this we are supposed to take group of 4. So this is first group. Okay, in the same way we are supposed to go with the second one. In the same way for the third one. And the fourth one. Okay, each is the D latch that we have discussed. So it is having D, Q and E, N pin. So we are having D, E, N and Q. Okay, so we are having the same in all. So I am just writing D, E and Q in all the D latches as we have learned earlier. Okay, so we are having this 4x4 memory structure after finishing this. Okay, so we are having this D, E and Q, D, E and Q. Okay, now see that the 4 bit register structure we had already gone through. Okay, so let us go for 4 such 4 bit registers. Okay, so we are having a group of memory registers, and we can write for that, that is 4x4 we are going for. Okay, so in that all the D inputs we will connect using a tri-state buffer. All the D input we will connect using the input tri-state buffer, you can say. Okay, so that is your inputs, that is I0, I1, I2 and I3. Now this we are supposed to connect to all the inputs. Okay, this we are supposed to connect to all the inputs. So these are the input part. So at a time only one 4 bit register can be accessed. Okay, because we are connecting all the 4 bit registers by the same line. Okay, so at a time only one 4 bit register can be accessed, that I will tell you later on. Okay, so that is the input part. Now the input part is being controlled by the write signal. Okay, so we are having this write signal, we are having this write signal. Okay, so this is the write signal which is controlling the input tri-state buffers. Okay, this enable for all the registers this enable signal for all the registers I am connecting together. So that will comprising of enable 0 for the 0th register, okay. Then again for this, so that will be enable 1. In the same way, this will be enable 2, and finally this will be our enable 3, that is EN3, that is the enable 3 that we are having. Okay, so input part is over. Now on the output side, all these outputs are being connected to the output buffer. So all these are being connected to the output buffer. So that is output 0. In the same way, all these are being connected to, that is output 1, all these outputs. Okay, in the same way for this, we are having, that is your output 2, all these are connected. Okay, and finally for this, we are having the output 3. Okay, so all these are being connected. Okay, now on the output side, the controlling is being provided by the read signal. So all the read signal we are supposed to add. So all the read signal we are supposed to connect like this. Okay, so this will be the read signal. Okay, and this will be the structure of a 4 cross 4 memory. Okay, this is how internally it will look like. Okay, so that is our, you can say that this is register 0, then this is our register 1, this is our register 2, this is our register 3. So we have taken 4 such 4 bit register and we make a group of memory registers. So each location can be viewed as a register. Okay, is it clear? So this is a 4 cross 4 memory location which is having 4 locations, and each location can store, that is the 4 bit of information. Okay, is it clear? Now try to observe the structure in this particular diagram. Okay, try to see that on the input side we are having input buffers. To control the input buffer, okay, we are having the write signal. On the output side we are having the output buffer. To control the output buffer we are having the read signal. Okay, and each register is enabled only when that particular enable signal is being enabled, otherwise it is not enabled. Okay, so to access a particular memory location, that particular register is supposed to be enabled. Okay, so the data is to be read from, or the data can be write from that or write to that. Okay, so if we summarize this diagram, then let us go with a very generalized diagram for this particular circuit diagram. Okay, so we will have a simpler diagram for a group of memory registers. So if we simplify this and we go for a block diagram, then this will look like Then on the input side, we are having only input buffers. Only input buffers we are having on the input side. Okay, that input buffer is controlled by the write signal, and we are having the four inputs, that is I0, I1, I2 and I3. Now we are having four memory locations in form of the four registers that we are having. So we are having these four memory locations, so we can write directly now, that is memory register 0, memory register 1, memory register 2, memory register 3, in that way. Okay, so these inputs are being given to this memory registers, so they are being connected. Each memory register is having this enable pins, that is EN0, EN1, EN2 and EN3, and we are having on the output side, we are having output buffers. Okay, so that is also connected with the memory registers, and we are having these outputs, that is output 0, output 1, output 2, output 3, and we are having the control signals for this, that is the read signal. Okay, so this is much more generalized block diagram for a group of memory, that is 4x4. So we are having 4 memory registers, each memory register is having this enable pin, only then that particular register is being selected. Okay, for write operation, this write signal must be given to the input buffers. For read operation, the read signal will be given to the output buffers. Okay, so this is much more generalized diagram for a memory register. Okay, now recall back the 8085 architecture that we had studied. To access a memory location, what is required? Address is required. Okay, so that particular address comprising of, to access this memory, these are the addresses, that is enable 0, enable 1, enable 2, enable 3. So if we want to access only memory register 0, then only enable 0 is active and rest are not active. So that will be the address for memory register 0. In the same way, the address for memory register 1 will be EN1. Okay, in that way we can make the address. So this is only a 4 location. So if you are going for more locations, then more enable pins are supposed to be added. Okay, and we are having very limited address bus in 8085 microprocessor. Okay, so this, the design of the memory chip, in that these enable inputs are being connected by means of an address encoding circuitry. Okay, so we do have an address encoding circuitry on this enable part. Okay, so the address decoders are being required. Okay, so for 4 lines, if we use an address decoder, then only 2 address lines are required, that is A0 and A1, to access the memory location. Okay, so if the value of A1 and A0 is 00, then this register is accessed. If it is 01, then this register is accessed. If it is 10, then this register is accessed. For 11, the third register is accessed. Okay, so in that way we can use the address lines and the address decoder to access the various memory locations of the memory. Okay, so that is regarding the address part. Okay, now see the data part. Okay, so we are having the data part in form of the input lines and the output lines. Okay, so basically these input and output lines are being activated only when the read and write signals are activated. Only when this read and write signals are being activated. Okay, so basically all these input and output lines are being connected together. All these are connected together. This is connected to the input 1. Okay, so input 1 is connected to this output 1. In the same way, input 2 is connected to this output 2, and this input 3 is connected to this output 3. Okay, so we are having these 4 data lines. Okay, that is your D0, D1, D2 and D3. So only 4 data lines are required for this. Okay, because it is a 4-bit structure. So we are having D0, D1, D2, D3 as the data lines, and we are having A0 and A1 as the address lines. Okay, along with the 2 signals, that is the write signal and the read signal, that we want to read from this memory or write from this memory. So basically this is the structure of a read write memory. Okay, which can be read, which can be write. Okay, so for a read write memory, it is a structure of RAM. Okay, so if we make much more generalized block diagram of this, okay, so what we have, let us see that. Let us make much more generalized block diagram. Let us make a much more generalized block diagram. So finally, we will have a structure for a read-write memory. Okay, so if this is our 4x4 memory that we have developed, okay, which is having A0 and A1 as the address lines. It is having 2 control signals, that is read and write. These are the 2 control signals, and it is having this 4 data lines, that is D0, D1, D2 and D3. Okay, so this will be for a read write memory of dimensions 4x4, means it is having 4 location, and each location can store 4 bit of data. Okay, so that is the generalized diagram. Okay, so we have gone through the designing of a 4x4 read write memory in detail up till now. Okay, is it clear? So let us see the different steps for writing to this memory. So when the data is to be written to this memory, the write signal is activated. Okay, and the data is inputted to this D0 to D3, and depending on the address, okay, that particular memory register is being accessed and data is being written to that particular memory address. Okay, in the same way, when the data is to be read from that particular memory register, then A0 and A1 will point to that, means A0 and A1 will be loaded for the address of that particular register, and then it is being read from that particular memory register. Okay, so the read signal is being activated, and that is being transferred to D0 to D3 to the microprocessor. So that is how the data can be read as well as write from this particular memory. Okay, so keep in mind that memory is comprising of registers. Okay, so each location can be viewed as a register. Okay, the size of the register will define the dimension of the memory. Okay, so that if it is a 4-bit register, then each location can store 4-bit of information. If it is an 8-bit register, then each location can store 8-bit of information. Okay, so that is the steps to read and write from the memory. Okay, as far as the dimensions are concerned, that we had gone through, that is 4x4, so that is the length and that is the width for a particular memory. Okay, length is nothing but the total number of locations, that is the locations, and width is nothing but the number of bits in each location. Okay, so this is the total number, this is the total number of locations. Okay, and this is the number of bits in each location. So that is how the dimensions are being decided. Okay, so if this length of the memory will decide the number of address lines required, address lines required to access the memory location. Okay, so you can write from the memory dimension that the number of locations, okay, let us much more generalize this. That the number of locations we can write, okay, let me remove this also. That the number of locations is equal to 2^2, that is number of address lines. Okay, so if we are having 10 address lines, then if we are having 10 address lines, for an example, okay, then 2^10 is 1024 locations. Okay, then 2^10 is 1024 location, and that 1024 location is also represented as 1K. That is also represented as 1K. Is it clear? Okay, so on the other side, if our memory is of 4K, if we take a memory is of 4K and we want to reverse the question, then how many address lines are required? Okay, then we need to do this thing, that is equal to 4 × 1024 locations we are having, 1K. You are supposed to always keep in mind that is 1024, that is 2^10, and that is equal to 1K. So that is 4096 locations you are having for 4K. So to find the address lines, you are supposed to just do log to the base 2 of 4096. Okay, so you will get 12 address lines. Okay. And there is one more method that you know for this 1024, it is 2 raised to 10, that is 1k, and your 4 is how much? 2 raised to 2. So you can do this, that is 2 raised to 2 dot 2 raised to 10 you can write. So that is 2 raised to 12. So that 12 you can find, that is the number of address lines. So that is how you can exactly calculate the number of address lines. Okay, the thing that you are supposed to keep in mind is that 2 raised to 10 is 1k, okay, and then whatever the rest number is there, you can put it in form of the power of 2 and try to find out the number of address lines by this, that is the number of locations is equal to 2 raised to number of address lines. Okay, so this is how you can find out. If so, this part, only this part of the memory dimension will tell you the number of address lines. Okay, for each memory location, how much number of bits are there, that is not being used. So keep this concept in your mind, that while calculating the number of address lines, only the length is being used, width is not being used. Okay, so keep this concept in your mind. Okay, so next time when we will meet, we will start with the 8085 and the memory. Okay, so in today's lecture we had gone through the designing of a very basic memory element which can store 1 bit of information. So we had gone through a memory element which can store 1 bit of information. Then we had gone through a register which can store 4 bit of information. Then a group of register, okay, that is the 4x4 memory structure we had designed. And after that we had gone through the basic structure of a read-write memory, okay. And from that we had gone through the calculation for the number of address lines which are being required for a particular memory location and vice versa. Okay, so that things we had done today. So in the next lecture we will discuss regarding the 8085 microprocessor and the memory. Okay, so that's all we have for today's lecture. Thank you very much.